And we're joined now by a lawyer, Jimi Abia. Good morning and welcome. Let me start by asking your question that so many people, including editorials, as a matter of fact, have been asking. What happens when a former governor on life pension emerges as Senate president or senator? Will they get two life pensions afterwards?
That is another part of our constitution that requires, to be tinkered with, and our laws also. There is no specific provision about such, to cover whether somebody can, get two pensions. However, the constitution makes provision in the fifth schedule, part one of the fifth schedule, which talked about the code of conduct for public officers. It provides that nobody can hold two offices at the same time. That means nobody can hold and earn from two offices at the same time, two public offices. So of course the person can hold two offices but cannot earn from the two. But it never made any provision with respect to whether the person can earn two pensions afterwards for the two positions which the person had held. But I am assuming that by virtue of that provision of the constitution that said that the person cannot earn from two positions, even after the person quits those two positions, the person should not be entitled to pension from the two positions, because the law, the constitution had already said he cannot earn simultaneously from the two positions. So I am also assuming, but I must say, state this clearly, that there is no express provision with respect to that. Now, if you go to section 4 of that same fifth schedule, part 1, it makes provision that somebody can earn a pension from one job which he has done, and while earning that pension, he cannot earn from more than one other source in public office. So that means that somebody can be earning pension and then also holding public office and earning remuneration from it, which I think is an area of our constitution that needs to be touched, that really needs to be touched. And of course, again, section 14 of that part one of the fifth schedule also makes provision that members of the National Assembly are exempt from, are exempt from this provision. So you find that
it's a source of concern for many Nigerians, because we've seen cases where some persons who were governors have risen to become presidents, or maybe vice president, as the case may be. So it's an area, but certainly let's give a background to some of these. Now there are at least 21 former governors and deputies in the Senate and President Muhammadu Buhari's cabinet. Let's look at some of the facts out here now. Now, the former governors now, who are now senators, are Bukola Saraki from Kwara State, Rabiu Musa Kwankwaso from Kano State, Kabiru Gaya from Kano State, Gotu Lakpabiu from Akwa Ibom State, Theodore Oji from Abia State, Abdullahi Adamu from Nasarawa State, Sam Egu from Ebonyi State, Sha'aba Lafiaji from Kwara State, Joshua Darie from Plateau State, and certainly there are still others again.
Yes, indeed. And others are Aliyu Magatakarda Wamako, Sokoto Ahmed Sani Yerima Zamfara, Denjuma Goje Gombe, Bukar Abba Ibrahim Yobe, Adamu Aliero Kebi, George Akume Benwe, and Isiaka Adeleke Oshun State. Now, former deputy governors in the Senate are Biodun Lujimi Ekiti and Eyinnea Abaribe Abia, while Danladi Abubakar Sani was the acting governor of Taraba State.
Now, former governors that are now ministers include Rotimi Amaechi of River State, Kayode Fayemi from Ekiti State, Chris Ngige, Anambra State, and Babatunde Fashola from Lagos. Now, let's see the position of the law in some of these states. Now, if you go to Akwa Ibom State, in Akwa Ibom, the law provides ex-governors and deputy governors receive pension equivalent to the salaries of the incumbent governor and deputy governor, respectively. A new official car and a utility vehicle every 4 years, one personal aid and provision of adequate security, a cook, a chauffeur and security guards for the governor at a sum not exceeding 5 million naira per month and 2.5 million naira for the deputy governor.
A very interesting provisions there. Let's come back to our guest in the studio. I mean, looking at all of this, you know, with the benefit of hindsight, you wonder if Nigeria were in the space that it is right now, where we're fighting corruption and all of that, the perception is, look, it's not going to be business as usual anymore. Do you think there would have been any such attempts to make these demands? I mean, four cars, chauffeurs, and all of that. Was it the prevailing situation that allowed for this kind of, you know, things to happen?
Well, it has always been there. You find that these are not, some of these laws were laws that did not come into force immediately, you know, within the administration of the immediate past government. You find a situation where some of these laws were simply amended. So these things have been there. And this is a part of the problem. You know, this is part of the problem that we've had a system, you know, that encourages impunity, that encourages people who are in government, you know, to make provisions that at the end of the day will continue bleeding the system, will continue getting benefit for them at the expense of the people they governed. At the end of the day, you find a situation where somebody who earns 18,000 makes contribution in contributory pension for his retirement. Now, at the end of the day, he is also contributing to his taxes, which will be used to pay the person who earns jumbo salaries even while in office. So you see a situation where there is a disparity. Now, you have the new Pension Reform Act, a situation where the person who is working and in the system is entitled to contributory pension. But you find a situation where they now still apply the old system of defined benefits. That's what this, that system of pension, which takes money from our tax resources, from the resources of state, to still pay these people. So while they are in government, they earn jumbo salaries, and when they complete their tenure, we still dip hand into our pocket to pay them. This is, it is reprehensible. It is morally reprehensible.
All
it
right.
is not right.
We'll still come back to this. Let's take you to River State, for instance. Now, the law provides 100% of annual basic salaries for ex-governors and deputy, one residential house for former governor anywhere of his choice in Nigeria, one residential house anywhere in River State for the deputy, three cars for the ex-governor every 4 years, two cars for the deputy every 4 years.
In Lagos State, the 2007 law allegedly provides two houses, one in Lagos and another in Abuja. Property experts estimate such a house in Lagos to cost about 500 million naira and Abuja 700 million. Now, others are six brand new cars, replaceable every 3 years, Mike.
Wow.
Furniture allowance of 300% of annual salary to be paid every 2 years, and about 2.5 million naira as pension. About 30 million naira pension annually. You want to respond to that?
That is outrageous. Now, you look at, indeed, it's outrageous. I don't know.
It's obvious that one would want to, you know, react and say this is outrageous. Mm. But are we saying, really, in essence, that those who have served the country, whether at the state level or federal, don't deserve some kind of security that they can look forward to?
Of course, they should be taken care of. Mm. The risk we run in not taking care of these persons is that it will also breed the corruption we want to avoid. So it is good to take good care of them. But of course, we have to put in a system which does not bleed the poor in the society, you know, for these same persons, you know, who have govern them, because I expect a situation where these things will be, you know, done looking at the prevailing situation, looking at, you know, the economy of these states, the country, and also the state of the people, you know, the people who they have governed. You look at a situation where they are saying that about 70 or 80% of Nigeria's population is below the poverty level, poverty standard. And then you find a situation where these people are earning
far above whatever is, you know, obtainable in any part of the world.
Let's make it a little realistic. I want to bring you, to put you on the spotlight here. Now, you said there should be a system that should not bleed the poor. If we have to put things in perspective, in real terms, in reality, what should have been enough? What are the things that could have been enough for to befit the office of the governor, an ex-governor, a deputy governor, or the ex-president or former vice president in the first place?
I may not be able to state fully what should be applicable, you know, all round. And of course, what I'm going to say here will be limited to my own personal opinion.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
But I think that a vehicle or two within 4 years, to them is okay. Then I also expect that these persons who have served could have a house, you know, for life, for them in any part of the country. One house, it's okay. Maybe renovated, you know, after 5 years or 10 years, as the case may be, it's okay. Then they have a system of contributory pension, which I don't see the reason why you make a law, you know, and it applies to the other persons in the society and will not apply to you. Then they should have a system of contributory pensions where they contribute part of what they earn, because they earn jumbo salaries even while in the office. They contribute part of what they earn in that system. So at the end of the day, you don't have to dip hand in the public till, you know, to also pay them. Then also you have a system where there are government hospitals. Government hospitals should not a situation where, for instance, in Kano, it provides that the ex-governor will be also entitled to treatment abroad and any part of the world. Mm. Now, that is the reason why you find public officers, they will not we are a situation where they do not concentrate in making sure that the health system in the state, you know, is up to standard, because they know that, of course, they and members of their family are entitled to treatment in any part of the world. So it should be you are entitled to treatment in general hospital in the state. So if you want this treatment to be up to standard, you better make sure that the general hospital works well.
Okay. Indeed. Now, let's move ahead now to Kwara State. Mm. In Kwara State, the 2010 law gives a former governor two cars and a security car, replaceable every 3 years, a well-furnished five-bedroom duplex, furniture allowance of 300% of his salary, five personal staff, three SSS, free medical care for the governor and the deputy, 30% of salary for car maintenance, 20% for utility, 10% for entertainment, and 10% for house maintenance. This looks like the specifications for the salaries and emoluments of governors and presidents and public office holders. Now, if we have to bring it, where is the, what's the role of the Revenue Mobilization Allocation and Fiscal Commission in all of this?
Of course, they are the ones that, you know, determine and also set out funds for some of this, for these things. So their role is limited, you know, in the sense that it is based on the laws which are made by the National Assembly. That's of course what they will implement. And of course, when you're considering also the provisions of the Constitution, they cannot go against the provisions of the Constitution, which first of all had already given right to the National Assembly to make laws. Now, apart from giving right to the National Assembly to make laws, also makes this not too good provision about issue of double earnings, you know, whether earning pension and also earning remuneration in office. So you find that the Revenue Mobilization and Allocation Commission cannot really, you know, go outside what is has been prescribed in the law. So I do not see any much blame for them in this system, in this structure.
Let's take you back to the fifth schedule that you talked about that actually looks like it does take care of the issue of pensions or, you know, double payments and all of that. So now a situation where a former governor is now Senate president, for example, in the case of Saraki, how do you determine, you know, or should the law really clearly state, okay, this you can actually get your pension from?
It should state it clearly. Because, like I mentioned, if you read those provisions, if you're not careful, you will think it covers what we are talking about. Mm. But if you read it properly, if you go to especially section 4, you will see where it made provision that somebody can earn pension and but cannot earn from more than two more than one other position while
let's give a background so that people can also get this. Now, the Revenue Mobilization Allocation and Fiscal Commission approves payment of 300% basic salary as severance allowances for political office holders on leaving office.
Now, the Code of Conduct Bureau and Tribunal, CCB Act, Section 8, states that a public officer shall not, after his retirement from public service and while receiving pension from public funds, accept more than one remunerative position as chairman, director, or employee of a company owned or controlled by any government or public authority, or receive any other remuneration from public funds in addition to his pension and the emolument of one such remunerative position. I guess you already addressed that.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And now Section 9 states certain retired public officers. One, retired public officers who have held offices to which this section applies are prohibited from service or employment in foreign companies or foreign enterprises. I'm not sure I do get that one very clearly.
Yes.
Well, there are provisions of the Act there.
Yes.
But this section applies
mm-hmm.
to the office of the President, mm-hmm. Vice President, Chief Justice of Nigeria, Governor and Deputy Governor of a state.
Indeed. Now, let's even look at the argument that the National Assembly is putting forward, that their counterparts in the executive arm, and indeed, even the CJN, who is not an elected officer, gets, life pension and all of that. How sound is this argument?
Well,
and why shouldn't they really be,
at
par if we say that the executive, the legislature, and of course the judiciary are at par? And they provide checks and balances and all of that for each other. Mm-hmm. Should anyone be...
If you look at it, for someone to have risen to become a justice of the Supreme Court, he would have had a career within the judiciary. And this career would have spanned years, in some instances, up to 40 years. A career that has spanned up to 40 years before he rose, to get to that position. Are you saying that somebody who has served Nigeria in a judicial position or in these positions, up to this, level, should not be entitled to pensions? Unlike in the case of these legislators. Now, legislators come into office every 4 years, renewable every 4 years. So the people can, withdraw their mandate and say, we are not giving you a fresh mandate. So for somebody who served 4 years, he earns for life simply because he served 4 years. He earns this jumbo pay for life. I don't think that is fair. If you look at it, it shouldn't be based on the fact that the Chief Justice of the Federation gets this, or justices get this, or then the legislator. We have to look at the terms of service. We have to look at how long, how did they emerge in these positions. You expect that a legislator would have had another job. It's not a life job. We are also, of course, there has been this clamor that even while serving as legislators, they should also, it should be part-time.
Mm.
But we are, you also already know that even before they got to the legislature, they had already been doing some other jobs. Are you now saying that they would also be earning pension from this? Of course, that is what is now applicable. That a situation where somebody had already served as governor, and then it because of this...
Well, let's not forget that all of these people we're talking about is... it's not all of them that would be past governors. Are we really looking at this, in terms of its merits, beyond the emotional response of, look, these people have been former governors, why should they be earning double pensions and other benefits?
Assuming the person was not a former governor, what was the person doing? The person might have been might have been in private, you know, practice, mm-hmm. or might have been doing some other job. And at that time, the person was earning and probably contributing to a pensions some other place. Now, the person is elected for 4 years. And you say automatically, the person now starts earning pensions after earning jumbo pay while in that office. I don't think that is fair. It is not to be compared to judicial positions where you see that, of course, before you can even get to that point in the judiciary, you must have served a number of years. You must have been known, you know, to have served a number of years before you can get to that position. And then even within the judiciary, you usually they rise in rank. So you find that the person had, would have served in that position or in positions in, within the judiciary for several number of years. The person is entitled to pensions.
All right, from what we've been talking about all this while, it seems that this is purely, there's a violation of the Constitution here when we actually see that some persons who were governors or deputy governors one way or the other are receiving pensions from here, and some persons who may have been governors and then became president or became vice president, as the case may be, who are said, because the Constitution was not very specific, and the schedules and the Revenue Mobilization Commission Act all made specifications. There's a violation here, obviously, but we don't see anyone taking these people to court.
Well, I think it will be subject to, you know, court determination. Of course, if somebody goes to court to determine, you know, for the court to determine, you know, these issues. But but having read the provisions of the Constitution and also the Code of Conduct Tribunal and Bureau Act, you will find that there is nothing expressly. If you go through it, you'll see that there is really nothing expressly, you know, stating that this sort of situation should not apply. That is, it actually calls for a constitutional amendment and also for a reform in the act, in the laws, you know, that are in place.
But based on the principle of delegated legislation, which the Revenue Mobilization has been given that mandate to handle that aspect of process or implementation, and the Revenue Mobilization Commission is a provision or is a product of the Act of the National Assembly. Mm-hmm. By that, has it not been taken care of?
Would it supersede the provision of the Constitution?
But in the case where the Constitution is vague, like you said, the Constitution is not specific, but an organ that is empowered by the Constitution has taken care of that. So
that's why I said it will still be subject to the court's determining.
Okay.
But I have looked at it that Section 1 of the Constitution and also Section 3 states, you know, that this Constitution is supreme, and it shall be binding on all persons and authorities within the federal. And if any other provision is inconsistent with the provision, shall to the extent of its inconsistency be void. Now, assuming that this provision of the Constitution is taken in its literal sense, you understand, without, you know, inputting things, I think that the provision of the Constitution does not really, you know, make it illegal or unlawful to pay these things. Now, if the provision of the if the Revenue Mobilization Allocation and Fiscal Commission has made something else which is contrary to the provision of the Constitution, I think that the provisions of the Constitution would supersede. This is you know, talking from a strict legal point of view. But of course, the court may look at a lot of factors. There are a lot of factors that, you know, courts look at, you know, to determine some of these things. For instance, let me give you an instance. When there was this, you know, clamor, and of course, Chief Gani Fawemi went to the court, you know, on the issue of appointing ministers from every state in the country. That was a landmark. That was a landmark. Now, that provision he went to court for was under Chapter 2, which is directive principle, fundamental principles and directive policy of state. Now, despite that, which the Constitution also says is not justiciable. Now, despite that, the court found, you know, reason, you know, to look at this thing and say that in the interest of the country, do you understand? In the interest of the country. And also, when he also raised some other issues, you know, Chief Ghanifa was known, you know, for some of this. Mm. And, you know, courts had to, you know, in judicial activism, had to come in and step in and say,
indeed,
look, we cannot allow these situations to continue. So I also expect that when some of these things get to court, it may not be exactly as I have, you know, opined, looking at the literal meaning of the law. Of course, the courts will look at a lot of things, you know, to give a decision that would suit, you know, the nature of the country.
Now, this obviously provides an opportunity. I mean, it's interesting that this particular demand's actually coming up as a result of attempts to look at the areas where the constitution should be amended. So this provides a good opportunity for Nigeria to do that. But let me even take you back to something interesting you said earlier, you know, to prevent a situation where public officers are left with no choice than to put their hands in the till, because they hardly have a sense of security that after I have served and all of that, that there's actually something to look forward to.
Yes.
So there is nothing wrong with governors, senators, House of Reps members, any public officer, you know, having some benefits as a result of service. But the real issue here is the magnitude.
Yes.
Or
the magnitude, and then, of course, also the fact that if they're also from what I've said, also the fact that it is not clear whether they can also be earning this and also earning
that,
remuneration while they're also still serving. So the magnitude of this and the fact that they could, you know, be earning from two sides. Mm. So that those are the things that, you know, should be looked at. But if it is whether the provisions should be made for them, you know, to give them some form of good life after service, of course, I think that is all over the world, you know, certain persons who have served in certain positions are entitled to these things, simply to make them comfortable, you know, for life. And the idea is simply is just to, you know, ensure that the issue of corruption, you know, they do not go dipping their hand in the till to make sure that they have enough for, you know,
to secure themselves.
Yes, to secure themselves. Mm. So that is it is good, but then the magnitude is what we call.
Can we, by extension, you know, allow the ordinary public servant, you know, have this kind of benefit to look forward to? Is this what the legislature really should be looking at seriously? Because you have situations where pensioners have to queue in lines. Many of them, unfortunately, lose their lives at the end of the day while waiting for these pensions that never paid, only to hear that a group of people have actually taken a large chunk of the same pension that's meant for people who have, you know, worked all their lives to serve their fatherland.
It is sad, really. And you know what? If in any case where an ex-public official is in good terms with the government of the day, whether in the state or at the federal level, and in some cases where they are not even in good terms, these payments are made on time, as and when due. They are not owed at all. They are not owed at all because, of course, this person understands that the previous person has a role to play in his political life and all that. So these payments are made as and when due. But you find a situation where the other person who has worked, not served in political position, but has served
the ordinary civil
servant, has worked for 35 years and retired and, you know, still has to queue for this pension that at the end of the day he doesn't even receive. So this is an anomaly. It's an anomaly. We should find a way. There should be a balance in all this. There should be a situation where, you know, the state understands that, look, anybody who has served is entitled to good life. He's entitled not only when he has served in political position, but when he has even served in the civil service. Those things that the state, the government has promised the person should be done for the person. Those pensions that the person is entitled to, the gratuity that the person is entitled to, should be paid as and when due.
All right. Well, Jimi Abia, thank you very much for talking to us on the pensionable or pensionability of ex-governors and ex-chief executives in Nigeria. Thank you very much for coming.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
All right.